Love You Bye, written by Scott Mills and read by the author. To Mum for being the best mum and my best friend. Many thanks to Emlyn Dodd for his contribution to the book and his ongoing support in my career. A great colleague and greater friend. If you look up Scott Mills on Google, and I hardly ever do this, I think in my whole life I've only done it 3 or 4 times per day, the most common searches are, is Scott Mills gay? Is Scott Mills married? Is Scott Mills dressed as a horse? Is Scott Mills in Men in Black 3? Is Scott Mills a hermaphrodite? Note, I might be getting some of these confused with my searches for Lady Gaga. You may be reading this book to have those questions answered. The short answers are, yes, no, probably, I don't know, I haven't seen it, no, I eat all dairy products. You may be reading this book because it was given to you as a present by a relative who misheard you when you said Chris Moyles, in which case the answers to the questions above are, no, no, probably, I don't know, I haven't seen it, no, he eats all dairy products. You might be reading this book standing in a bookshop, wondering whether or not to buy it. I won't attempt to influence that decision. That's yours to make alone. All I would say is, buy the book. This is the story of a boy who suffered from crippling shyness and panic attacks, who went on to get his dream job, move in with the star of Baywatch, get a car with his name written down the side, make Katy Perry cry, bleed uncontrollably on live TV, administer a disastrous colonic irrigation, be stalked by an 80s pop star, win awards, and somehow avoid the sack for being drunk on air. In May 2012, as I find myself sitting on a carousel horse in the middle of Baku in Azerbaijan with Jedwood, all I could think to myself was, where did it all go right? By the book. Scott Mills, London, July 2012. Chapter 1, Self-Diagnosis. Audience figures for radio shows are measured by a company called Radar. They give 2,000 people a diary to fill in each week and ask them to tick boxes to show what they've listened to and when. Critics obviously question how accurate this system can be, but this is still how it's done. I do, however, know precisely how many people tuned in for my first ever radio show. I have the exact figures. It was one. She was my mother. I would have been around 8 years old, and my poor mum would sit for hours in my room and listen to me, with my 2 cassette machines, pretending to be a DJ on Radio 1. Every so often, I tried to double my listening figures with the help of my younger brother, Wesley. But this was very rare, and the ratings would soon plummet when he got bored and went out on his bike. The great outdoors of Southampton just never really appealed to me at that age. Why would you want to be out with friends when you could be doing the chart countdown in your bedroom? I am fully aware how geeky this makes me sound, but that really was me. Mum, or Sandra from Eastleigh, as she was called when she wanted a shout out, was my only listener, my biggest encouragement, and is to this day my best friend. And it can't have been easy. She's been through a lot over the years. As well as dealing with my neuroses, self-doubt, panic attacks, and drinking problem, not to mention the shock of seeing David Hasselhoff naked, she always manages to laugh off the awkward situations I regularly put her in. When I accidentally locked her in my house with the alarm system on, so when the alarm went off she had to convince the police through the letterbox that she wasn't a burglar, she managed to see the funny side. When I recently took her to a salon to have her eyebrows tinted, she again managed to laugh off the disaster. She has blonde hair but somehow ended up with thick black eyebrows. You may wonder why Mum has put up with all this. It may be that she feels partly responsible for my existence. She did have quite a key role in my being here, so I think she wants me to turn out all right. The other person with a major say in my being here is my dad, Pete. The thing everyone says about my father is that he looks like Bruce Willis. Ladies love him. Laura and Becky, who have worked on my radio show, have both pondered what it'd be like to marry my dad, and whether being both my assistant producer and stepmother would make things awkward. This is something too grotesque to even think about, and I will dwell on the idea no more. I was never really close to my dad growing up, mainly because he works so hard, and at the time, I thought he and I were very different. He's very practical, owned his own removals company, loves football, and was quite the lad when he was younger. Nowadays, he and I are much closer, and we get on brilliantly, although I still can't see any similarities between us. For a start, he regularly lies about his age, one time even pretended to be my brother, and then there are his horrendous jokes. It was Mum who I was closest to, and I will always be grateful to her for regularly getting me out of PE lessons. I was embarrassingly bad at all sports, except, bizarrely, the long jump. Thankfully, Mum was as good with excuses as I was bad at football, so my PE teacher found that the young Scott Mills was constantly suffering with anything from back pain to bird flu. Although I didn't hate school, and I got on fairly well with people, it was always the escapism of music and my radio shows that made me happy. I think at that age we're all imagining we're somebody else, whether it's pretending we're scoring the winning goal at Wembley in the back garden, singing at the O2 in front of the bedroom mirror, or winning Ready Steady Cook while making spaghetti hoops. We're all being someone we're not, and I was no different. I saw being a DJ as a way of acting out a part, and it's really only since I've been at Radio 1 that I'm finally comfortable being myself on air. When I was 12, I decided that just sitting in my room playing at being a DJ wasn't going to get me a job doing it for real. It was also likely to drive my mum insane sooner rather than later. So, for the good of us both, I needed to take the next step. Frequently asked questions. Number one, how do I get your job? I'm asked this a lot, and it's not, how did you get your job? Or, how do I get a job like yours? It's always specifically my job they want for themselves. As if I'm going to tell them that. Sure, here's the key, take it. However, I can tell you that hospital radio is where I started off. Student radio is also good if you're a university, but I was 12, so I headed to the hospital. If you're lucky enough never to have been seriously ill, you may not know what hospital radio is. These are usually registered charities, manned by volunteers, who run radio stations piping entertainment to headphones by patients' bedsides. The volunteers give up their spare time to be DJs, trying to bring some joy to people who often have little to smile about. Another team of people will give up their evenings and weekends to visit the wards, asking if anyone would like to request a song to be played on the station. The answer usually being, no, leave me alone. Every so often, a patient will request their favourite tune, usually My Way by Frank Sinatra, or another equally disturbing number to remind them of their possible fate. When visited again later, the patient will almost certainly not have remembered to listen in for the song they requested. My hospital radio station was a strange place. I encountered two distinct gangs inside those walls, the Tuesday night gang and the Sunday night gang. Like the Bloods and the Crips, they loathed each other and never mixed. However, I was scheduled to be a member of both gangs because I was given Tuesdays and Sundays as my evenings to help out. The Tuesday night gang had been in the game for a long time. They were all around 60 years old and veterans of the scene, having played Jim Reeves and Tony Bennett to those wards for as long as anyone could remember. They treated me with suspicion, possibly suspecting I was a Donnie Brasco character, intent on infiltrating their group and undermining them. I watched the Tuesday night gang in the studio, studying how they worked and the equipment they used, trying to learn something from every visit. They also watched me like a hawk, determined to discover what I was up to. The Sunday night gang was completely different. They were all about 18 or 19, the young pretenders, the future, willing to let me help out and take part. No wonder the Tuesday night gang hated them so much. They would also let me do things I wasn't supposed to, like use the mixing desk, and I absolutely loved it. The first person who ever sat me in a chair and said, "Right, go on then, try to do a bit of proper radio," was Lee Mosdale, who remains a good friend of mine to this day. It was my chance to show how much I'd learned during my time at the hospital radio station. I recorded a show, operating the equipment, and working everything myself. This was my first show outside my bedroom, and although my listening figures hadn't gone up, Lee was the only one, it felt like the first big step towards my future. I carried on as a member of the Sunday night gang, and was still treated with suspicion by the Tuesday nighters for about 2 years. But then it all went wrong. There was a mole. Someone had blabbed to Tuesday night that Sunday night had let me on the radio. That was it. They knew I was trouble. Someone of my age on the radio. The next thing I knew, I received a letter from the hospital committee saying that I wasn't allowed onto the premises anymore, something to do with insurance. Tuesday night had me whacked. Well, my hospital radio career had been whacked, and I was told if I ever went inside the building again, I would be classed as a trespasser. I was 14 years old and had been fired from my dream job, or at least from the job I'd hoped would pave the way to my dream. And I wasn't actually being paid, so it may not technically have been a job. But still, I'd been fired. Things I have learned. Number one, plan for a quick getaway. You may be surprised to learn that hospital radio was the first and last radio station to give me the sack. There are so many stories of DJs being escorted off the premises by security for saying the wrong thing or having a bad set of radar results. It seems strange that's not happened to me. Yet. Being fired as a DJ can be quick, and it can be brutal. One programme director famously held a presenter meeting where he played them all their new jingles. When one DJ piped up and said, "My name wasn't on there," the programme director replied, "I know, see me in my office after the meeting." I've never kept many personal items at work for that very reason. If I'm escorted off the premises, I want to make it quick. I'll shove my mug and my signed photo of George Alligator in a cardboard box and be out the door. My way back from my hospital radio sacking came through work experience at Ocean FM, a proper radio station. Every Saturday I would turn up and do whatever menial tasks were asked of me. I would happily have dropped out of school and spent all of my time at the studios if I could. Ocean FM gave me a sense of purpose and made me feel much happier and more secure. So it's a mystery as to why I began to suffer from crippling panic attacks at around the same time as I started working there. Anxiety runs in my family, and my nan and granddad both suffered very badly. The first time I had an attack, it was absolutely terrifying. I had no idea what was happening, and I had no control over my body. It came on suddenly, and I became obsessed with the idea that I was going to die. Imagine being short of breath and your body feeling as if it has totally seized up. I would get in such a state, and it was my poor mum who had to try to calm me down. At first, the attacks were few and far between, so I could deal with them, and I learned to recognise the signs of one coming on. But as time passed, they became more frequent and intense. Things eventually got so bad, I couldn't even leave the house. Mum would regularly have to call the doctor out to me because I was convinced I was going to die during an episode. I used to work myself into such a state that I couldn't see how I would ever feel normal again, and sometimes the only thing that would calm me down in the midst of an attack was knowing that the doctor would arrive to reassure me. Anyone who has experienced anxiety attacks will know exactly what I mean. I used to sit on the sofa for hours with my head in my hands, crying and saying, "I can't go out, I can't go out, I can't see anyone, don't leave me," to my mum over and over again. I would constantly check my pulse, and my heart would race so fast that I would panic more and think I was having a heart attack. Even talking about it now brings all of those horrible feelings back. Mum would drive me to school, and we'd sit outside for ages while I built up the courage to go in. She tried to tell me everything would be okay, but I couldn't even get out of the car, let alone walk through the gates. It was the same with Ocean FM. I was desperate to go there because I loved it so much, but I'd get short of breath and so stressed I couldn't face leaving the house. It was like a form of agoraphobia, and some days were better than others, but I didn't feel like I could handle anything. I couldn't cope with having to interact with people. Anyone who has ever suffered with any kind of depression or anxiety will understand that feeling of being totally cut off. I hated the thought of being around people, and yet at the same time, I desperately wanted to be normal. Eventually, I had to take almost 6 months off school, and in that time, I became a virtual recluse. I didn't want to see anyone. One friend, Lawrence, would come round and call for me all the time, but I didn't want to go out. It's weird because we'd always been really close. I had even let him be a co-host on some of my pretend radio shows when I was younger, but I just wanted to be on my own or with my mum. Things I have learned. Number two, Self-diagnosis is not good for you. The other problem I had when I was in my mid-teens was always thinking I was ill. That happens with a lot of people who are anxious. They're always thinking their symptoms are a sign of something much more serious. I was convinced I had something really wrong with me, and I didn't help myself when I borrowed a self-diagnosis book from the library. Kids don't know how easy they've got it these days. In these modern times, the internet can, at the touch of a button, convince you that you have a life-threatening disease. Back then, we really had to go out of our way to fuel our paranoia. Diseases I was convinced I had, aged 14. Fatal familial insomnia. Progressively worsening insomnia, leading to hallucinations and delirium. No known cure. Death within 18 months. Eosinophilia myalgia syndrome. Flu-like neurological condition. No known cure. Sometimes fatal. Necrotizing fasciitis. Flesh-eating disease, treated with high doses of intravenous antibiotics. Without treatment, leads to death. Gynecomastia. The abnormal development of large mammary glands in males. See also monkeypox, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, alien hand syndrome, the plague. My brother Wesley is 4 years younger than me, and because we're very different, we weren't close growing up. We were usually bickering about something and annoying each other. He once broke one of my now that's what I call music records, and I was so furious that it erupted into a full-on fight. What he had done was probably the worst thing you could do to me at that age. I was fairly well behaved but fragile, but my mum was convinced Wesley would end up a juvenile delinquent. Luckily, that prediction turned out to be inaccurate, much to the relief of his fiancée Mandy and my niece Emily. As we grew up, things changed, and we only really bonded about 5 years ago. Wesley is a timber framer, and I'd bought a house in Kentish Town. As he's a perfectionist, he spent about 6 months doing the place up. He virtually had to rebuild the top floor, and he did an incredible job. I'd go round every night, and we'd talk for hours. Things shifted between us. We realised that we had a lot in common, and that actually, we really liked each other. We became extremely close. My anxiety and panic attacks meant I left school with minimal GCSEs. I wasn't at school for enough time to study for them, and homeschooling was out of the question because even that used to stress me out too much. I think I turned up to 2 exams. I'm too ashamed even to look at the certificate to see what I got. At the time, I was gutted that I failed all my exams, and it made me feel quite worthless. It really worried my parents too, because I had nothing to fall back on if my grand DJ career plan failed. And as I couldn't even bring myself to walk through the door of the radio station for months, that was looking more and more likely. After about 8 months, with help from my mum, my doctor, and some anti-anxiety medication, things finally began to improve. Mum and I agreed that the next step was for me to go back to Ocean FM. Somehow I knew that if I could just make it through the door, I'd be okay. I remember Mum driving me to the station on my first day back so clearly. I felt a mixture of panic and excitement, and I was doing deep breathing throughout the entire journey. We sat in the car park for a good half an hour while she calmed me down and did her best to convince me that everything would be okay. Then I got out of the car, walked towards the main radio station entrance, pushed open the door, and walked in. Rather than feeling stressed about being back there, it actually made me feel calm. I don't know if it was because it was a place I knew and felt comfortable in, but I felt happy for the first time in ages. It was a massive accomplishment for me to have actually left home, and the outside world wasn't anywhere near as scary as I built it up to be. Over time, being back at the radio station really helped to build up my confidence. Although it took me a while, I was able to get my anxiety down to a manageable level and lead a normal life again. Things I have learned, number 3. People really do say, "I'll make you a star." I always thought that only happened in movies. Remember the film Cocktail? Doug says, "When you see the colour of their pennies, you know you've got talent. Stick with me, son, and I'll make you a star." I never thought anyone would say that to me, especially not the boss of Ocean FM in Hampshire, but he did. Though for legal reasons, I should point out there was no mention of panties. Chris Carnegie was the programme director and stopped me as I was walking down the corridor. He'd seen me around the studios and vice versa, but I'd always been too scared to talk to him. After a brief chat, he asked me if I wanted to be on the radio one day, and I replied, nervously, "Yes, I'd really love to." Summer was coming up, and he explained that was when they often needed cover for people who were away on holiday. Although he couldn't promise anything, he said that he would see if he could get me some shifts. "I can't even remember what, or even if," I replied, because I was so stunned. And then it happened, just like in the movies. As he walked away, he said, with a smile over his shoulder, "Send me a tape and I'll make you a star." I remember thinking it was the coolest thing I ever heard. People should say that more, I think. It brought a certain glamour to a small local radio station. Back then, I used to spend hours sitting up into the early hours, either at home or at the studio, making demo tapes of radio shows. My audience figures had plummeted over the last few years. I'd gone from one listener to zero. But Chris's offer to listen to my demo was a chance to get some real-life listeners who weren't related to me. I recorded a new demo and handed it to Chris. Amazingly, after taking it away and listening to it, he took a chance and put me on air. I was only given a one-off show, filling in for a presenter who was away, but it was a massive deal. It was my first paid radio work, and all I could do was hope for the best. I still remember it so clearly. The news finished, and I nervously read out the weather. I played a jingle, then a song. I was still suffering with pretty bad anxiety at times. My mum dropped me off before I was due to start the show, and I started saying I couldn't do it. She eventually managed to talk me round by telling me that it could be the beginning of something I could do for the rest of my life. My slot was a late night on a Sunday, and it certainly wasn't perfect. But I got through it, and Chris called me afterwards to congratulate me. He was honest and said that a lot of things needed improving, but he also said that he could see past my nerves, so he was willing to give me another opportunity to show what I could do. Everybody has someone about whom they can say, "Without them, none of this would have happened." For me, that person was Chris Carnegie. There was no reason for him to give me a chance. One, I was a nervous wreck. Two, I would need to get permission from my parents whenever he offered me a shift. Three, I wasn't even that good. But Chris heard something he liked, and for the rest of that summer, whenever presenters went on holiday, he got me to fill in for them. The more shows I did, the more comfortable I got. Sometimes I'd be on air 4 or 5 times a week, and I began to relax into it and sound much more natural. Ocean FM was part of a larger broadcasting company with several different radio stations in the same building, so I'd jump between them when I was needed. I'd be playing chart hits on Power FM, then 2 hours later, I'd be playing 60s music on Gold AM. I was 16 when all of this was going on. The summer of 1989 is a time I'll never forget, because it all felt a bit magical. It still does. Chapter 2, A Car With My Name On It. I carried on working at Ocean FM whenever they needed me, and later that year, the unimaginable happened. I signed my first proper contract. I had been offered my own show, 5 days a week, from 1 until 6, in the morning. The hours were hardly sociable, so I decided I needed some transport. A few weeks later, I collected my mean machine and rode it home. Dr. Fox may have had a Harley Davidson, but I was the proud owner of a Honda Vision scooter. I felt true freedom, finishing my show at 6 in the morning, getting on my scooter, and riding full pelt at 30 miles an hour back home. By the time I got there, about 40 minutes later, I would be so cold, Mum would have to sit me next to the radiator to thaw me out. It soon became clear that this was not a vehicle to be seen on in public. I was so embarrassed by my scooter that I used to park it around the corner from the radio station so no one could see it. Frequently asked questions. Number 2. When did you first realise you were gay? A lot of people seem to think there's a moment when a big light goes on and it's ping, oh my God, I'm gay. That certainly wasn't the case with me. There was a point when I realised that maybe girls weren't for me, though. I was about 15. One of my friends had a car, and I remember one day we went down to Western Seafront in Southampton with two girls, his girlfriend at the time, and her friend Sammy. She was the kind of Sammy who would have put a smiley face on top of the I in her name. It was quite clear that Sammy fancied me, and before I knew it, she was trying to snog my face off in the back of my mate's Vauxhall. I almost had to prise her off, and I went home that night feeling annoyed that I didn't like her in the way she liked me. She called my home phone the next day and told me that maybe we should just be friends. I agreed. I never saw her again. I met my first ever boyfriend, whom I'll call Nathan, at around this time. He was a couple of years older than me, with his own place, and I was so into him, in the way you are when you're that age. We were friends first, but we started spending more and more time together, and I fell in love for the first time. But what would my parents say? I had kept the whole thing a secret, fearing their reaction, but after a few months I decided I had to do the right thing and tell my family I was gay. I was scared about what they'd say, but finally I plucked up the courage and sat down to talk with Mum. I broke down in tears almost immediately and simply told her, "Mum, I'm gay." "I know," she replied. I wasn't expecting that. I was probably fearing my brother's reaction the most, and Mum said she would break the news to him gently. "Wesley, Scott's gay," she said. "I know." It took Dad a little while to get his head around it. He was a bit funny for a while. Even though he had had his suspicions, as everybody obviously did, I think it was hard for him. After he'd had some time to get used to the idea, he was really supportive, but I think it was a lot for him to come to terms with. I don't think either of my parents had met anyone gay before, or not knowingly, anyway. After about a year, I moved in with Nathan. I'd left home and my parents, and Littlehampton was my oyster. There was a casino, the Look and See Visitor Centre, and of course, the town is home to the famous Harbour Park Amusement Park, where the fun will never set. I visited none of these places. The hours I was working, and the fact that I was the most super square person you could ever meet, meant that Nathan and I would go to work, then go home and eat, sleep, wake up, and do it all again. We didn't even drink. I was living the life of a 45-year-old when I was 17, and I was quite happy with that at the time. The journey to work was too far for my scooter. Instead, I'd leave at 9 o'clock each night and get a train to Swanwick for about 11, then walk to the radio station in Park Gate. I'd be on air from 1 to 6, then travel back to Littlehampton and repeat, repeat, repeat. Sometimes Nathan drove if he was on a night shift. We would go in together, and I would sleep in his car outside the radio station for a few hours until I had to go on air. It was a tiny car, and so cold and uncomfortable that I don't think I ever slept properly. I was exhausted most of the time. Just before Christmas 1990, a new boss joined the Ocean Group. His name was Jeremy Scott, and one of his first ideas was to tell all the DJs he decided to have a clear out so many of them wouldn't have a job in January. Understandably, that festive season wasn't the most cheerful. By this time, I had moved to the Drive Time show on Power FM. It played current music, a bit like Radio 1, so it suited me better. Jeremy used to terrify me. He would ring the studio to let me know that he was listening in his car and that I'd better be good. Those calls would frighten the life out of me. I had an incredibly tense Christmas, most of which was spent trying to think of other things I could possibly do with my life. In January, Jeremy called the staff into his office one by one. I remember going in thinking, this is it, It's all over. But I was one of the lucky ones. Jeremy spared me. Despite being very relieved, I knew things were unstable at the station, and I started to feel unhappy about working there. Everyone felt they could be sacked at any moment, and when morale is bad at a radio station, I really think the listeners can tell. The bad atmosphere was having a serious knock-on effect on everyone working at Ocean. My mum noticed that I was quite down about things, and she even said to me one day, "I do think you're good at the radio, but I'm not sure you're cut out for it. It seems like it's quite a tough business, and I don't think it's for you. It seems pretty cutthroat, and I don't want you to end up getting hurt." In a way, she was right, because I was still a nervous little teenager, and I did let things get to me. But now I had my foot in the door, I wasn't about to turn and run. Ocean wasn't going to drive me out through fear. I would stand my ground. I had made up my mind. This was my dream, and I was not going to be denied. A few weeks later, I left. A man named Steve had called the newsroom at Ocean and left a message for me. I'd never heard of him, but called him back. He explained that he was Steve Orchard, the programme controller at GWR in Bristol, and asked if I'd be interested in a move. The Ocean Group was, on the whole, an incredible experience. It was a big factor in helping me to become more outgoing, and it was thanks to Ocean that I really found my feet as a presenter. Because of that, I felt really guilty about leaving, and on the day I told them I was going, they made me feel like I'd let them down. I'd worked my way up from being a T-boy to having a full-time DJ job, but now I was leaving for something bigger and better. Anyone in my position would have done the same. Jeremy reacted exactly as I expected him to. He was angry and told me I was making a huge mistake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.